Hi folks, Canadian Prepper here. So today on the channel, we're gonna talk about the wonderful world of canines and your emergency preparedness planning. So let's get to it. So there are many roles for dogs in the world of prepping. Dogs can keep watch, they can be used for threat deterrence, they can be used to guard a place, they can be used to retrieve upland or waterfowl birds, they can guard livestock, they can haul your gear, they can even haul you in some cases. They can be used for search and rescue, and even hunting bad guys. Some breeds can be used for vermin control, and they even can be used for emotional support in times of crisis. So in terms of security, there are three main functions that a dog serves. One of those is the ability to detect a threat. Because dogs have superior senses than humans, they're able to hear better. In some cases, they're even able to see better, and they're also able to smell better. So a dog can alert you if somebody's been in an area, if you notice your dog smelling around the yard in a way which is a little out of the ordinary, then that might be an indication that something or someone has been in that region. Of course, they're gonna be able to hear a threat, and most dogs are going to let you know about it in the form of a bark. Pretty much all dogs are capable of detecting threats and barking. The next role of a dog is the ability to deter a threat. Now, not all dogs are gonna be able to do this. You're going to need an intimidating breed of dog in order to do this. Remember, the point here is not to actually neutralize a threat, but it's just to prevent somebody from wanting to trespass into an area or potentially commit a crime. Most larger breeds, like German Shepherds or any bully breed for that matter, are going to be a deterrent. So dogs can detect threats, they can deter threats, and they can also defend or defeat threats. Now, in order for a dog to be able to defend or defeat a threat, it's gonna need one or two things. It's gonna have to have a built-in prey drive, which is something which is breed-specific and typically genetically programmed, or it's gonna actually have to be trained to be a guard dog or an attack dog. I've used a lot of different saddlebag-style dog backpacks for my dogs over the years. Lots of these don't have the dog's comfort in mind, they don't provide big enough pouches, and they don't stay on that well. The best one that I've found so far is the One Tigris Mammoth Dog Pack. This one comes with really big pockets. There's bungee cords along the sides that you can strap gear onto. It's built exceptionally tough. It's 1000 denier Cordura. And as you can see here, my dogs have really put this thing to the test. I can't say enough good things about this pack. It's perfect for your doggy bug out bag. So of those big dogs that we talked about that can be used to deter threats, there's gonna be a handful of breeds that are actually bred to defeat threats. Dogs like pit bulls, for instance, are ones which have been bred to actually neutralize large predators. That's why they always either bite the neck or the head, the face region of whatever they're attacking. And unfortunately, unless properly trained, these dogs can be potential liabilities, which is why a significant amount of the fatal attacks on people are with the bully breeds. A lot of these fatal attacks tend to be on either the elderly or children. If you're talking about a full-grown group of men who are trying to trespass into an area and commit a crime, you cannot rely on a dog. A dog should not be your sole means of security. Other breeds like German Shepherds, if they're properly trained, will be able to have the discernment to know when to attack and when not to attack. And in most cases, the goal is going to be deterrence, because of course, if you train your dog to attack somebody, that opens the door of many different legal liabilities. Dogs can be easily defeated. They should not be relied on for self-defense. One of the biggest threats of dogs in an actual grid down situation would be something that was happening in Detroit for many years. And that was wild packs of feral dogs attacking people. And a lot of the fatalities that occur as a result of dog attacks are the result of packs of dogs, because dogs are a pack animal, just like wolves. Dogs will naturally want to work together. in this respect. This is something that you could potentially employ in your own security strategizing, having multiple dogs. But once again, dogs can easily be poisoned, they can be shot. There's a variety of ways to neutralize a dog if you're a person who has bad intent. And without proper training, they're only going to be as survival savvy as their owners. For example, I've taken Marshall duck hunting before and fishing, and I try to offer him some of the fish or the duck, and he's just not interested in it. I'm sure if he was very hungry, he would eat it, but it still is something which is unusual to him. Dogs are going to eat just about anything when it comes down to it. So I'm not too worried about storing food for Marshall, even though dogs are adapted to eat a primarily carnivorous diet. Dogs will eat anything. Marshall will eat carrots, tomatoes, all kinds of types of vegetables, but their diet should be very protein and fat rich because that's basically what they've subsisted off of for thousands of years. If he had to, he'd eat rice and beans just like the rest of us, although he probably would need his diet supplemented with a bit more protein. You have to keep in mind that they're not trained to hunt like wolves. They probably aren't even trained to attack. Most dogs, unless they have that prey drive, unless they've been trained to attack, they're not gonna attack. Even the most aggressive barking of dogs, I've heard a dog breeder say that the dogs who bark the most tend to be the ones that actually bite the least. Another thing to keep in mind is that training is a major commitment, especially with high energy dogs which come from working lines. I have a dog which comes from a working line, and I can tell you that it's a lot of work to keep that dog busy. And even once dogs are fully trained, their instincts are still hard to overcome. This is why there's a lot of examples of police dogs who, in the heat of the moment, failed to respond. Marshall, for example, got into an accident a couple years ago where he chased a rabbit. It was just like, you know, his genetics kicked in. I mean, right when he sees one, it's a trigger to attack. No matter how much I train the dogs, it's very, very hard to prevent them from chasing a rabbit. Now, I know it's possible, but what I'm saying is the amount of time that it's going to take to train to do that is not something that everybody's going to be able to commit to. Another thing to keep in mind is as emotionally attached as we get to our dogs, and I can totally understand how a person can get really emotionally attached to a dog. I'm really emotionally attached to my dogs, but it's important to remember that at the end of the day, they're not humans. And we run the risk of getting too emotionally attached to a dog in a time of crisis where that attachment might actually cause you to do something which may actually put human beings or other people at risk. Now, in terms of selecting the right dog breed, what are some criteria that you should look for? One criteria is health issues. A general rule of thumb is that the bigger the dog, the chances are they're gonna have more health issues and they're not gonna live as long. The opposite end of the spectrum is smaller dogs who tend to live longer and tend to have less health problems. For example, lots of German Shepherds have a condition called hip dysplasia, which they get later in life. Now, this is gonna vary from breed to breed and it's gonna depend a lot on their stature. I'm hoping Marshall doesn't have that problem, but you never know. The next thing to think about is the intelligence level of the dog breed that you're choosing. Just because a dog breed isn't in the top 10 of intelligence dogs doesn't mean they're not going to be useful at detecting and deterring threats and possibly serving a variety of other purposes that we talked about at the beginning of the video. It's commonly understood that dog intelligence is defined by the instincts of the dog, the obedience levels of the dog, and its ability to adapt to various situations. Some dog breeds are gonna be more socially and emotionally dependent on people. They're gonna require more attention. Others are gonna be able to do their thing all day and never be around people at all. Now, according to pet behavioral specialist Sarah Hodgson, some dogs are gonna be social and emotionally dependent on people, so they're going to be easier to train and far more receptive to what our vision is of what they should be doing. But these dogs are going to have little intuitive smarts. And the reverse is also true. So if you have a dog who has high intuitive smarts, if they have a lot of that wolf instinct left in them, they're probably not going to be the most obedient and they're not gonna be the most social. One example of this is hounds. They're not gonna be the most receptive. They're not going to be the most obedient in all cases, but they are going to have superior senses of sight and smell. So there's kind of a trade-off between obedience and the dog's natural instincts and abilities. As a general rule of thumb, bigger dog breeds tend to be smarter, but that's not always the case. There's a few breeds of smaller dogs which are actually up there in the top 10 most intelligent dogs. Another thing to consider, especially for survival purposes, is weather tolerance. You don't want to get a dog like a Greyhound or a Doberman Pinscher in a very cold climate. The reason why, of course, is because they're not gonna have the fur to survive that climate. And then you're gonna have other dog breeds where they're just gonna have too much fur to survive in a hot climate. Now, as great as dogs are, they can also be a liability. There are many stories of dogs walking through the forest with their owners. They'll see a bear or they'll see a cougar or something like that. They'll charge after it, and that predator will come back towards the human. In the same way, a yappy dog is probably not a good thing if you're trying to keep a low profile in a grid down situation. That might just draw attention. So having a dog that can be trained to not bark is going to be important. Another thing to consider is the lifespan of the dog. So the bigger the dog, they're probably going to have more health problems. So right now my dog has detected that there might be a threat and he's freaking out. If I wanted to, I could get him to calm down relatively easily. Not all dogs are gonna be able to do that. All right, Marshall, come on, sit down. You did a good job. Good boy, that's a good boy. You got him, you got him. So Marshall should hopefully, if we're lucky, live to between 10 and 12 years. That's a ballpark for German Shepherds. I think the record is closer to 20, but that's incredibly rare. Now, little breeds of dogs who are going to be great detectors of threats, and they're gonna hear threats that you might not hear, they're gonna live a long time. They're not gonna require a lot of food to eat. So that's something to keep in mind. You know, I'm not saying that small dogs have no value to preppers and survivalists, especially from an emotional standpoint, they absolutely can be a benefit to you and your family. So you can't go wrong having a dog if you're a prepper. Even if you're not a prepper, dogs are awesome. I truly probably have a better relationship with my dogs than I do with most people. You can always trust a dog. They're always gonna be there for you till the bitter end. So that's why I love them so much. But they are a big responsibility and you have to factor that into your life. It's not enough to just have the dog just for the purpose of doing the thing. You know, they also need your companionship. They also need your attention because they are a domesticated animal. They're just like human beings in that respect. Anyways, guys, thanks for watching. Stay safe out there. Canadian Prepper out. The best way to support this channel is to support yourself by gearing up at CanadianPreparedness.com. The best quality products at the best prices. Use discount code SURVIVALPREPPER, all caps, all one word, for 10% off. Thanks for watching. Stay safe.